Good evening, afternoon, I guess, still. I'd like to call the order, Calistoga Planning Commission regular meeting of September 12th, 2018. Roll call, please.
Note for the record that all commissioners are in attendance.
Thank you. Would you all please rise for pledge allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And moving to C, public comments. Public comments is an opportunity to address the planning commissions on items of interest to the public that do not appear on the agenda. Comments should be limited to 3 minutes. The commission cannot consider any issues or take action on items raised during public comments. Do we have anybody that would like to come up and have anything to say? If not, we'll continue on to adoption of the meeting agenda. Do I have a motion to adopt the agenda as presented tonight?
So moved.
I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Great. Okay. Communications and correspondence, staff.
Nothing's been received since distribution of the packet.
Okay, thank you. Consent calendar, minutes approval. Do I have a motion to approve minutes as presented, or do we have any comments?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Great. Okay, moving quickly down to public hearings. G1, Municipal Code Amendment ZOA 2018-2, consideration of a recommendation to the City Council regarding a proposed amendment to the Calistoga Municipal Code 17.48040C3 to increase the number of marijuana plants that may be cultivated outdoors on certain residential zone properties for personal use. Staff, please.
Thank you. As you'll recall, the Plan Commission made a recommendation to the City Council when this was, these regulations were initially drafted, and hit upon allowing two plants to be cultivated outdoors on a qualified parcel. It's allowed in the rural residential hillside, R1 single family district, and the PD districts that allow single family residences. They are not allowed in the multifamily residences. And so currently the provision is up to 6 plants per household, which is required by state law, and we allow 2 of those to be cultivated outside. During the community forums that we had in the springtime on dispensaries, it was brought up that the council promised that we'd take another look at possibly increasing the number of outdoor plants once we'd been through a harvest, cultivation and harvest cycle, and see if any complaints had been lodged and whether it would be appropriate to possibly consider increasing the number of plants outdoors. And so that's the council is asking you for your input. I don't really have too much to share. The city of Napa, except for an update on the city of Napa, which does allow up to 6 plants either indoors or outdoors, and the fact that we have received no complaints during last fall. The police department did not receive any, and neither did the planning department. So the council's not necessarily providing guidance on how many plants, but they'd like your feedback, and that will feed into a possible ordinance amendment. So if you haven't answered any questions, but I don't really have a recommendation. We're still feeling our way along here, and there's not really any kind of model to follow.
Thank you.
We don't know. I should just add, we don't know how many, if any, residences cultivated outdoors because we don't require a permit. That was one of the decisions we consciously made. And so we don't require a permit, so we don't know how many, but we also know that we haven't received any complaints, at least filed officially with the city.
Okay, thank you. Anyone on the commission have questions of
I just
staff?
Wanted to clarify really fast. This is as for personal use, so currently medicinal and recreational are being treated under the same guidelines? Is that what?
We don't distinguish. For personal cultivation, there's no distinction between medical and recreational.
Okay.
Do you know when the state established the number of 6 plants, how they arrived at that number?
No, they did. It was completely, it just went all over the place, and they just happened to land on that. There wasn't any, you know, scientific thing. I can't recall if there was any, I don't recall if there was any direction in the ballot measure, you know, the referendum that made it state law. So there's really no guidance one way or the other.
Seemed to me that, you know, if there were a limit, it ought to be based on yield and what would be likely consumed on site rather than farming to create product for the street. But that has already passed us. I mean, whether it's indoor or outdoor is another issue. It's six that they can do, whether they want to do it indoors or outdoors.
But your question is the salient question.
Yeah, I spoke to a small dispensary owner last year, and he said he was able to stock his dispensary for an entire year with six plants that he could harvest 36 pounds from. So obviously a very skilled and determined grower, but you know, that's a pretty significant fit within the laws of the canopies and the.
Do you know if it was in? It was outdoors.
Oh, it was outdoors.
They were all outdoors.
All outdoors, and I used UC Davis techniques. You know, bending the. I mean, a professional grower, and he pulled 36 pounds. So
I think I've gotten 36 pounds of tomatoes on a 2-point.
Or zucchini.
There
but
you go.
So I'd just like to point out that we do have some, you know, limitations as to off-site visibility,
right.
Cultivation within 300 feet of youth-oriented and religious facilities. Can't do it in a garage, but, you know, in certain extraction methods, et cetera. So,
and I see that you can amend the code to go back to 2 in the future became a problem. And the fact that there hasn't been any complaints so far is a good indication that there's no...
I just can't tell you what the magic number is. It depends on how successful you are, what strain you're cultivating, you know, how far away you are from the next neighbor, which way the wind is blowing.
Boy, Lynn, you seem to know a lot about this.
I've researched it thoroughly.
Could you,
I guess the only issue could be is that you could probably have a higher yield on the outside.
Mm-hmm.
It's costly inside, won't get the yield you would get from the outside. So that might be an argument for limiting outside plants.
Right. And very few people have the skills of the person, I'm sure.
Lynn, has there been any complaints? Since Napa has it, do you know of any problems?
No, it's been fairly recent in Napa. I don't know that they've gone all the way through a cycle yet.
Okay. Any other questions to staff? If not, this is a public hearing. I will open it up. Would anyone like to come forward and address the issue at hand? No one in this audience wants to come up and talk about marijuana. Impressed? I'm impressed. So, seeing none, I will close the public hearing and come back to do a discussion amongst the commissioners. Anyone have comments?
Have we seen any comments in favor of this?
Or? I was just going to say, so since this was published, I've heard from 4 individuals in town who have expressed interest in increasing the number of outdoor plants allowed. They didn't say what number they were seeking. I don't know if we're comfortable going to 6. 4 seems reasonable, given that there's been no complaints, but I have heard from some locals who are interested in growing more than 2 plants outside.
That's 4 in favor and none against that we've heard of,
I mean, I come back to, you know, Commissioner Abernathy's point is what does it take to supply potentially, I would say, 2 people in a household enough cannabis for whatever purpose. And since there hasn't been a drumbeat that says this is not enough, I really don't know why we're doing this.
But to enter the real world that we live in, I believe that if it's 2 or 4 or 6, people are going to do what they're going to do unless they're caught going beyond 2 or beyond 6. I mean, they will. They'll just do it. I mean, until
they're
caught, there's been no complaints, there's been no problems. And if people in this community, we're only talking about this community, did not like what was proposed, they certainly would be here tonight, and we don't have anyone that wants to talk on this particular matter. So I'm not I'll be very clear, I'm not a pro-marijuana person other than for medicinal purposes. that's where I feel, and I come from a, an environment of in service where marijuana was a bad thing, and in the war, you don't mix those kind of things, but this is not the same environment, it's a different world, and I guess we have to trust our community. I'm expressing my opinion here that, there again, if you left it at 2, they could do 6, you'd never know, probably. If you put it at 6 and they did 2, who cares, right? So it's just, I think it's just reaching in the air and grabbing a number.
Well, that's what the state did.
Right. I think you're right. I do agree that that's exactly what they did.
So I don't think that we're doing anything less than apparently the state of California has done. You know, so I'd say split the difference. I don't see the need. The need is not here. The need has not been voiced to the city. So like I said, where's the drumbeat? If it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Right. Now, if you're you don't have a green thumb and you're trying to supply enough medicinal cannabis for you and your partner for 12 months, and the little plants that you end up growing are this big, then probably 6 times this is going to be more helpful. Because there's nobody in town who's out there as a master of the art and technique of it. Well, like you said, it's not really sure why in front of us. But it's here.
We do need to pick a number, folks. And I don't have a problem with 6, because it can be 6, it can be 4, it can be 3, it can be 2. They're going to do what people do, and unless they're turned in, because I think we're back to a situation if something smells, and whether it's 2 or 6, and there's an issue, if the whatever code we have on the record is going to be enforced. But
hey, well,
beyond that...
Let me throw on a hypothetical then. Let's say we approve 6 plants, and that does turn out to be sort of a nuisance. Now we have the problem of enforcing something that we've approved to be able to knock it back, because we just go, whoops, that was a mistake.
You don't think people would be aware that if it was a mistake and it was brought to the public's attention, that they would go backwards any different than if they had 2 and something happened? We're back to pros and cons. That's why it's so hard to come up with any number.
Well, it's a matter of multiple regulations that we're layering on top of what the state allows people to do. So us as Calistoga, as the city, is now putting certain regulations to the city. And if it's a matter of deregulating, going back up to the
Well, state. We don't have an outcry for more.
Yeah.
So maybe what Commissioner Wilkes said, we split the difference, go to 4 or something, or 3, and just let it go. You know, so I'm okay with that. And you know what? We have to try.
Yeah.
It gets a test run, and if there's a problem,
baby
we'll address
steps.
It. Yeah. So
maybe next year we'll go to 6.
Commissioner Abernathy, would you like to make a motion?
I'd like to make a motion. I move the planning commission
Too late. Did you hear it?
I heard it. The folks at home didn't, but
nobody else did.
Want me to do it again, or y'all hear?
Yeah, go ahead and read it again, just to make sure it's of record and it's on
I move that the Planning Commission adopt a resolution recommending to the City Council approval of a zoning code amendment to increase the number of marijuana plants that may be cultivated outdoors for personal use to 4.
Do I have a second?
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Abernathy.
Actually not.
Okay. Moving on to G2 under public hearings, 1339 Lincoln Avenue Demolition Design Review, DR 2017-10, consideration of a design review application for demolition of the one-story building located at 1339 Lincoln Avenue. Staff.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you.
$25.
You are tough tonight.
He was only here for 15 minutes. You're all familiar with this building at 1339 Lincoln Avenue. It's the former Lincoln Avenue Spa that's currently fenced off because it's in a deteriorated condition and represents a hazard to the public. The building was constructed in 1890 and has been determined to be eligible for listing in the California Register of Historical Resources. As you know, we have an unreinforced masonry building ordinance whereby we're trying to get all of the hazardous buildings in town, commercial buildings reinforced, and we've been fairly successful with that. When it came to evaluating this one, there were two engineering evaluations to determine the best way to seismically retrofit it, and the conclusion was that it could not be retrofitted because of the poor quality of the original building materials and the fact that the building actually only has three walls, and the fourth wall, the northern wall, is made up of the brick, two-story brick building next door, the Cyberlick building, which you acted on at the last meeting. Therefore, the property owner has applied for demolition of the historic building, and in order to do so, you need to grant design review approval per the municipal code. Three of the four of you are on the Building Standards Appeals and Advisory Board, and we brought this matter to you along with the two engineering reports, and the board concurred with those assessments and found that it was infeasible to retrofit the building, and the building official, the city's building official, again, has determined that it does represent a hazard to the public safety and does need to be removed. Unfortunately, we had two evaluations of the building conducted by a qualified historic or architectural historian, which are included in your staff report. She also did what is called a plan review letter report. Once it was determined that demolition was probably going to be the course of action with specific recommendations, and she recommended a mitigation measure, which involves documenting an as-built survey using laser scanning, and that will be translated into archival quality digital images that can be utilized for future exhibits, documentation, and research associated with the property in Lincoln Avenue. In order to approve this demolition, because it's a significant environmental impact, a focused environmental impact report was prepared and circulated pursuant to the CEQA guidelines. We did receive one comment letter, and that was from Caltrans, and it was basically like, get an encroachment permit if you're going to be involving Lincoln Avenue. But that is the only comment letter we received, and that did not require any changes to the draft EIR. So there's actually two actions that will be required tonight. I'm sorry, I left off one of them on the summary. So you have two resolutions, and the first one involves certifying the final environmental impact report, adopting a mitigation measure, which was the laser scanning that I referred to, findings of fact, and a statement of overriding considerations for the demolition of the building. And then the second is approving, it sounds strange to call it a design review application, but that's the process that the municipal code dictates. So you'd be approving the design review application for the demolition. We have included in the conditions of approval, in addition to the laser scanning, that what's actually going to be a dismantling process versus a wrecking ball knocking down the building. The applicant has committed to actually dismantling the building stone by stone, and some parts of it might be able to be repurposed in the building or given to the museum or something. So basically, during the dismantling process, they would label on the backside of each stone the number assigned utilizing the 3D laser scanning images, and they would shrink wrap and store the rock, the pedimented parapet with the stone date plate, and salvageable wood windows on pallets in a dry and covered location for possible reuse or donation. So we did, like as I mentioned, worked as closely as possible with the architectural historian to come up with the best approach under unfortunate conditions. Nobody wants to lose one of our very few historic buildings on Lincoln Avenue, but unfortunately, that was the conclusion that was come to. So I'm happy to answer any questions. And also the applicants with us. Let's see.
I have none, and...
I have a question. Was this ordinance created by the state or by the city? Who is it?
The unreinforced masonry, though?
The earthquake retrofit.
It's a mandate by the state, and we did adopt the ordinance about 5 years ago, I believe.
Was there any potential subsidies or grants to help property owners deal with the financial hardships?
Unfortunately, there was a program briefly for that, but that's lapsed. And we don't have a redevelopment agency, which was used in some cities like Healdsburg to offset the cost. But we have been successful in getting many of them retrofitted, so we only have a couple outstanding. And as you reviewed the CyberLick one last meeting, that's right. Moving ahead. So after this one is demolished, we'll be down to one building.
Okay.
I think there's also some tax credit. If they were able to go through with the project, get it registered, then there would be some tax benefits doing it that would help offset the...
If they choose to pursue but actually registering the building, right?
That wouldn't apply.
I understand a public safety hazard trumps everything, but it's just unfortunate to implement something that has such a hardship for property owners. They have no choice. It's either go through with the renovations or demolish.
Fortunately, this is the only case where we're going to have to demolish.
Renovations is infeasible in this.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Okay, this is a public hearing, so I will open it up. And anyone wishing to speak on this subject, please come forward. We have a lot of folks in the audience, and I'm not quite sure why you're all here.
Quiet.
Kurt, don't fall asleep, buddy. It's a long day. Seeing none, I will close the public hearing and bring it back. Any questions, additional questions for staff before we take an action?
Well, I would say that, you know, we've heard this in detail at the Building Standards Committee, and I think I can speak for both of us that Mr. Coates has been very responsible in the process of this. Yeah, I'm sorry, in Cunningham, in the process of the preparations that went through this and the amount of analysis that I was impressed was incredibly thorough. It was, I think, going every which way but Sunday to try to find a solution, and there ain't no solution. I just, you know, as they say in Maine, you can't get that from here. So. So in that respect, this seemed like an inevitable.
Yeah, and I reinforce that, the fact vision. That they're labeling every stone. They're taking it going to the extremes at every as much as possible. That in itself is commendable. So.
Yeah, with a very thorough documentation, one would hope that will have some level of second life as the property would move forward.
Yeah. Anyone else?
No.
If not, I'll entertain a motion. And then you might ask you for that first motion to reread it, and we can act upon it after you have read it.
If you can just read the title for attachment one.
Okay.
Yeah, that'll be the first one, acting on the environmental document.
Yes.
Certifying the final EIR. So it's attachment one to your staff report. If you could just read the title of that.
Commissioner Wilk, would you like to do that?
Yes. I move to certify the resolution number 2018-XX, certifying the final environmental impact report and adopting a mitigation measure, findings of fact, and a statement of overriding consideration for the demolition of the building located at 1339 Lincoln Avenue.
Second. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And secondly, I would like to move that the Planning Commission adopt a resolution approving design review application DR 2017-10.
I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Great. Okay. That concludes public hearings. Moving on to matters initiated by commissioners. Anyone have anything exciting tonight?
I would.
This afternoon?
Just like to make the comment, and I don't know why everyone is here tonight, but one thing I would like to note is that the Tribune has been actually publishing our upcoming sort of agendas in small form, and I have received a number of comments of how helpful that is for people to actually know what's coming up.
I'm assuming that's why I got a couple of people approaching me about this meeting.
Yeah.
And
so
could I just note that you can sign up for eNotify and receive notices of every Planning Commission, City Council meeting, and the agendas and all of the materials.
But I would say, you know, hats off to Pat Hampton for taking that forward.
Right. And I appreciate the folks out in the audience. If you have a statement you'd like to make, there, young lady, you can come up and make it if you'd like. With the fact that we're closer to the microphone, I can't hear you.
The Weekly Calistogan also puts in notice, advance notice of the meeting.
Great. Thank you very much. Anything else from commissioners? Thank you, Commissioner Wilkes. Nothing. You're up, Lynn.
I am happy to report that we have a new senior planner starting October 1st. His name is Zach Tessinger, and he comes to us from the city of Roanoke Park. He also has a law degree in addition to a master's of city planning, so he's going to be an extremely valuable resource, I think, to the city. He and his young wife live in Santa Rosa, and so he does not need to relocate. And I am very excited about him starting. So I think he's going to be a great addition to the staff.
Great.
Great.
And I would say you're doing a great job considering we've been how many months now by yourself? You don't even want to think about it.
Two, 3 years, I think.
No, it was a couple months.
Anyway, so thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, that's it. If anyone up here has nothing else to bring to the table, we'll ask for an adjournment. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.